years and how often I thought, well, I can take a walk with Gary. That's all about her plays, and the childhood and the family growing up in the suburbs in Milwaukee. Like doing so with Gary. All the plays would talk about travel, trains, and all of that. Not to mention my early youth series, where we have the plays about when I was 5, when I was 15, you know, and all of that. So when I was thinking about what do we do to capture some of that, I thought maybe we just dip our toes in a little bit of everything. So we're going to start off with, I think, what every group I've ever read it with and every time we've ever performed it, many of us think is one of the most perfect things she ever wrote. And that, of course, includes the word perfect being in the title. So the first piece we're going to read, which will be read by Robert Kerrigan and Reggie Thompson, is called Flamingos Are Perfect.
Robert Whitfield?
Yes.
I'm Daniel Garnett. Do you recognize the name?
No, I'm sorry, I don't. Oh, perhaps you were a student of mine when I was called to Columbia.
Well, this is the 37th time you've done this to me.
Mr. Gamet.
Garnett, do you recognize those poems?
Oh, Mr. Garnett. There are thousands of poems given to the Venice Poetry Anthology every year.
You've never even read them.
Well, actually, my assistant.
Your assistant puts aside the poems of the well-known poets for you to consider and reject all the rest, right?
Not exactly. Every now and then, an unknown poet gets through. Have you ever been published, Mr. Garnett?
Of course, quite widely. If you've ever read any of my cover letters, you know.
The Lost Muse, Lucid Stone, Pebble, Melbourne Road, Buckshot, Vaseline Review. Oh, Lucid Stone has very high standards, Mr. Garnett.
They took one of my weakest poems.
No, it's an excellent credit. You should keep on trying.
Keep trying. Look, I have 93 rejections from the New Yorker, 71 from the Atlantic, and 43 from the American Poetry Review.
Well, I guess that's whole business, as they say. I'm late now for my appointment, if you'll excuse me.
Please, Mr. Whitfield, please, will you read the latest act of my poems?
Mr. Garnett,
my best.
Let me touch.
I will refuse to let you go until you've read my poems.
Then I'll have to call the doorman to call the police.
I'm begging you, Mr. Whitfield, begging. I've been writing for 25 years. Just turned 45. It's now or never for me. Just read them. If you honestly don't like them, tell me. But at least read them.
That man is a violent Stevenson character. You can see how the streetlight's jaggedness vibrates horror. Life is a thin edge, held up by flamingos. Well, this is good, Mr. Garnett. I like it very much. A thin bridge. I'm going to accept this one.
Oh my God, I can't believe it! The Venice Review. This is the happiest day of my life. I'm going to call my mother to know. She always says I'll never get anywhere as a poet.
It's a good poem, Mr. Garnett.
Do you think I should change Stevenson? You know, I was thinking of Jekyll and Hyde, but most people don't think of Stevenson as violent.
No, I think Stevenson works very well.
What about vibrance? I had ripples. You know, sort of like horrific ripples and munches of screen.
I think either ripples and vibrates works.
And what about the flamingos? Maybe herons or pelicans? They have long legs, too.
Well, heron, I don't know. And they're too common. And pelicans too puffy. Flamingos are perfect.
I don't know. I just don't know. Let me think about it and then send it back to you.
Well, that's not possible. I'm leaving for Paris next Monday to teach a summer workshop. And I have to send all the accepted poems to Mr. Farley, the editor, by this weekend. Your poem is just fine as it is. Trust me. Oh, taxi. Okay. Would you give me the poem?
Are you sure about my rates?
Yes, Mr. Garnet.
And the flamingos?
Yes.
I still don't know.
Oh, driver, 47th Street and 1st Avenue, please. Mr. Garnet, will you give me that poem, please?
I still can't.